And we heard that hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, the one من قام رمضان من قام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. The one who stands every night in prayer in Ramadan, then all his previous sins are forgiven. But from that is dua. Calling and beseeching Allah. This is the month to beseech Allah's forgiveness. This is the time to beseech Allah. Ramadan is not like any other month. The gates of Jannah are open. The gates of An-Nar are closed. Allah wants to forgive. Allah is looking to forgive. And the last third of every night, in normal days, Allah is waiting for those calling upon Him. What about Ramadan when He increases in forgiveness, when He increases the opportunities? The Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith of Abu Hurairah, related by Tirmidhi and others, that there are three people whose supplications are not turned away empty-handed, that do not get answered. Three people. The first of them, the fasting person, when he breaks his fast. The second person, the just ruler. And the third person, the one who is being oppressed. These three categories, people who fall into these three categories, their dua is not rejected, it is responded to. Allah answers it and responds to it. So how are we going to avail these opportunities? Where are the best places to make dua? Have we thought about it yet? Because it's no good that Ramadan comes upon us and then we start thinking. That's not preparing for Ramadan. Let's think now. Okay, after Fajr, do I have time before I go to work? Yes, perfect time. Straight after Fajr, I'll make dua. I'll sit there until I have to go to work. I'll sacrifice half an hour, 20 minutes, 10 minutes extra of my sleep time. That I'd go back and have a little nap, lie down, whatever. I'll sacrifice that. Instead of going to sleep, I'll make dua. I'll beseech Allah. And just before suhoor, or just after suhoor, I've still got a few minutes. Instead of wasting that time, I put my hands up. I don't talk to anyone, I talk to Allah. Have we thought about and planned when and where we are going to make dua? When it comes to walking, dua doesn't have to have your hands raised. Dua doesn't have to be in a state of wudu. Have we thought about, as we're walking, we have to now train ourselves, instead of just walking and thinking about things, we're going to actually start making dua. Our heart is going to be engulfed in the remembrance of Allah, completely. So when it comes to dua, let us remember and let us not forget the fact that Allah is Al-Hayy, the one who becomes shy when his slave raises his hands. Allah is shy to turn that slave away empty-handed. So this is the one you are calling upon, the one who keeps giving. There's a sticker that I used to see when I used to enter the masjid all the time. It says, Allah is the one who gives and forgives, but man is the one who gets and forgets. It's so true, isn't it? Allah loves to give, and He keeps giving you, and He keeps giving you opportunity after opportunity, and you don't take them. And then Allah doesn't stop giving you, He keeps giving, and He forgives your shortcomings. But we keep getting opportunity after opportunity, and then we don't take advantage of them. We're neglectful, we waste them, and we forget about all of those ni'am, the bounties that Allah has bestowed upon us. So at the very least that we can do at least for the ni'am, the bounties that Allah has blessed us with, is to make dua, just to give thanks to Allah. When it comes to dua, let us remember that the hadith of Abu Umama, he says that the Prophet ﷺ said, at every breaking of the fast, Allah has people who He redeems. He lets them go and frees them from the hellfire. So what we should remember is when all of that food is in front of us, iftar time. Just imagine, there's people at that table whom Allah is going to release from the hellfire. They would have been going there, but Allah is going to forgive them. So isn't it time that we raised our hands and begged Allah that we be one of them? But it takes a certain concentration and consistency for a person when he sees that lovely food, especially after the long days of fasting that we're going to face. After so many years of ease and comfort, now you can see all the varieties of food in front of you. Everyone's, you know, the lips are watering, the taste buds are going, and now it takes a certain strength, doesn't it? Certain patience. Now to raise your hands. We've seen it so many times, people get busy talking. Distract ourselves from the food a second, just talk, talk, talk. No. If you want to talk, talk to Allah. At that moment, that is a blessed time, so let's not waste it, inshallah. Tayyib. moving on to other deeds to do in Ramadan. The first that we're going to mention, inshallah, is we know about Qiyam. But what happens in the masajid today, you know, we have the dispute and it keeps going, this dispute about is it 8, is it 20, whatever. And then because of this dispute, you find people, they start leaving the masajid. And then, subhanAllah, and we hope that when they leave the masjid, they're actually going, they're leaving because they're going to pray more and longer at home. But many a time, what happens is these people, they go, they leave the masjid, and they don't pray anymore. They leave after 2, after 4, after 8. After 8, there's a mass exodus. Even though a very little bit of Quran has been read, they've heard hardly anything. Mass exodus, off the masjid, we've done what we have to do, khalas. Go home. And is this what you're meant to do? Is this Ramadan? Ramadan is for worship. The Prophet ﷺ said, whoever prays with the imam, he prays the qiyam, and he finishes with the imam, and he leaves with the imam, it's like he spent the whole night praying. Okay, if you can't pray the whole night like the Prophet ﷺ used to do and the companions used to do, at least do this. If you can't, you know, you don't like the 20, then find a place that prays 8 so you can leave with the imam. Find a place that reads whatever you can read, because there's many different masajid and they pray different lengths. Find a masjid that you can leave with the imam. So at least, if you can't pray all night, you have the reward of praying all night. It's sensible, maximize the opportunity. The Prophet ﷺ, once a woman came to him, and she was meant to come, she was meant to make hajj with the Prophet ﷺ. And when it came to hajj time, he ﷺ noticed that she wasn't there. So when she approached afterwards, in Ramadan, sorry, before Ramadan, she approached afterwards, and he asked her, what kept you from making hajj with me? She said, we had 2 camels, and the camels, we used to use them to bring water. And my husband and my son, they took the camel and they made hajj. And there was only 1 camel left and we needed it to make water, so I couldn't make hajj with you. The Prophet ﷺ says to her, to get her that reward. The Prophet ﷺ wants to fling everyone into Jannah and get them the highest places in Jannah. And he says to her, when Ramadan comes, go and make Umrah. Because when you make Umrah, in one riwayah, it's the reward of hajj. In the other riwayah, he says to her, that when you make that Umrah in Hajj, when you make the Umrah in Ramadan, it's like making Hajj with me. So you haven't missed out the reward, you're still going to get it. A comfort to her heart. And blessings, trying to get her into the highest ranks of Jannah. The Prophet ﷺ, this hadith is very important, it's going to lead us into the next major topic section when it comes to the deeds in Ramadan. Zayd ibn Khalid al-Juhani, he says, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, whoever gives iftar to someone, a fasting person, he provides them with the food to open their fast, whether it be a date, whether it be a sip of water, or whether it be a huge banquet. Whoever gives them, provides for them the food to break their fast, then he has the reward for their fast. And no one loses any reward, rather he just increases. Giving iftar, you get the reward of those fasting people. This points us in the direction of sadaqah. Sadaqah, when it comes to sadaqah, let's remember the Prophet ﷺ, Ibn Abbas says he was the most generous of people at all times. But then he was most generous when it came to Ramadan. There must be a secret in this. There must be something special in this. The Prophet ﷺ, another hadith, authenticated by Sheikh Al-Albani, he says, the best deed that you can do, or from the best deeds that you can do, is to make your brother happy, or to pay off his debt, or to feed him. Sadaqah. This is the action of the Prophet ﷺ. Imam Shafi'i, he talks about this, and he says, when it comes to Ramadan, people get busy with their fasting, people get busy with Qiyam al-Layl, but they forget about all these other deeds. These deeds, when it comes to fasting and when it comes to Qiyam al-Layl, these are for yourself. These benefit yourself. They're very important. The Prophet ﷺ didn't used to leave them. But the Prophet ﷺ also, generosity. He used to look for the communal benefit.